So this is lecture number 10 and we are almost there with the applications of image processing, right? Last week we discussed about image restoration in some detail, particularly about Veena filtering, right? Now we are going slowly towards image segmentation, which is one of the most powerful applications of digital image processing. And the first baby step towards that is obviously detection of edges, right? And then once you detect edges, you may have to link them together and discard some of them so that the edges look like a continuous thing rather than discrete values, right? So we'll discuss in detail on this particular aspect throughout this week, okay? So let me just start with a very beautiful flower example here, okay? So you just consider this image, and obviously as a human, you know that you are looking at something which is a flower, that is the foreground. And then there is some nature which is there at the background. Maybe this hibiscus, which is the red color, is on the background. And you may want to actually do exactly that. You want to segment this image into two parts, a foreground and a background. Foreground being the rose and the background being whatever is there at the, back of this flower, right? And one important characteristics you can readily see is the boundary of this flower, which is very, very evident, right? Let me just use a pointer to really mark this out. So if you see here, so this region, there is a sudden jump, right? And that's what we ideally start with. So in this case, for example, if I find out the edges and see which is sort of mostly continuous or dominant, you're basically finding out the border between the foreground and the background. And that really is the motivation in many cases to first determine those edges and then do segmentation further. Okay. So we will start with that. So our primary objective is to move towards something like image segmentation, where you actually separate out the foreground from the background, or many such foregrounds from the backgrounds. Okay. So it need not be binary. It can be multiple levels, right? So we'll discuss all that. But let's actually start with edge detection. Okay, so for edge detection, as we already know, we studied about the beautiful kernels, right? Beautiful filters somewhere in lecture 3 or 4, right? And when we started the spatial operations, and then we discussed about all the differencing. And we already know that a differencing operation is a high pass operation which beautifully highlights the edges. And we already know some of these kernels, right? Roberts, Laplacian, Sobel. Everything is very known to you by now, and the use cases also should be known to you by now, just to refresh, okay? So this is basically what this basically does, edge enhancement in this direction, right? And that is basically your Y, right? So this basically does it in this direction, right? And then you can have the diagonal directions also, right? This way and this way, right? So all different possibilities, you can actually use these kernels to highlight edges. So if I use only this guy, all the sort of, right? I mean, if I use only this guy, all the, this direction kernels will get excited, right? I mean, sort of enhanced. And similarly, if I use this one, all these guys will get enhanced. And again, a naming convention issue is that this should be Y, right? And this should be X, because for us, this is X and this is Y. I will correct that when I upload the slides. Sorry for that. Okay, so that's an important aspect. And then you have, so basically this is not a symmetric kernel. Always remember that it's a 2x2. So there's no center pixel. So basically you start with centering the kernel such that this guy will be the aligned with the pixel that you want to calculate. Okay, so that's the problem here. And then Sobel is sort of more symmetric. It's 3x3. And then in this case, for example, again, you can see that this is in this direction, this is in this direction, and this is sort of in this direction. I'm taking the positive values as the direction. Okay, so that is the convention which is followed. So this is basically highlighting all the edges in this direction only. So if I use, let's say, only this kernel, okay, so only this kernel, then obviously, if I use only this kernel, then obviously the edges which are in this direction will be enhanced, right? And if I use this kernel, only the edges in this direction will be enhanced. I have an example, a MATLAB example for you to really go in depth in this direction. Okay, so these two, if you see, is first order differencing sort of, right? I mean this can be considered as second, because it is not, I mean, immediate neighbors, not immediate neighbors, right? It's just the previous neighbor. So that aspect is there. And then Laplacian, the point I wanted to convey is, like, all these operators are directional. They are not isotropic. There is a directivity associated with that. But in the case of Laplacian, if you see, it is actually isotropic, right? Because there is no directivity. If you see in any of this direction, you can argue that the directivity in these directions are restricted. Yes, that's correct. If you strictly follow these directions, there's no edge enhancement in this direction, only east, west, north, south, right? So basically, yeah, I think that convention, maybe I'll just make it clear. So we already know of these conventions, and I want to restrict this idea you should actually be aware of. So this direction is north, this direction is east, this direction is west, and this direction is south. So anything in this direction is northwest, right? And this direction is northeast, this direction is southeast, and this direction is southwest. So this convention, please keep it in your mind, because many a times when we talk about edge enhancement, we talk about this. Okay, so the Robert, Sobel, Prewitz, all these operators are actually directional. They are anisotropic in the sense, like, there is some directivity associated with it. But the case of Laplacian in general, for example, this guy, I think these two actually are purely isotropic. You can argue with me that these are not really isotropic. Yes, I agree, because they are not really enhancing edges in the northeast, northwest, southeast, and southwest directions, right? So that concept is there. Now let me just show you one example of applying all these kernels on the cameraman image and see the difference, okay, for yourself. So let me just quickly go to the MATLAB window. So here I've created one code I'll share with you. So basically, read the cameraman image, apply the Roberts filter, apply the Laplacian filter, apply the Sobel filter, just like what we saw, the kernel that we saw on the slide. Let me run this out and see what happens. Okay, so the figures have come. So let's actually check the, this is actually the, the Roberts operator. Okay, so you can see actually X direction is your this direction. And those directions are enhanced. You can see it, right? I mean, this is a vertical. Let me just zoom in. Okay, so if I zoom in here, you can see this is the vertical direction, right? That is completely gone. But on the other hand, the horizontal direction, say, I think this is the best example. Let me just go and see this guy. Okay. Sorry. Okay, so you can see this edge. This particular edge, which is actually running along the X direction, is enhanced like the best, right? So that's a beauty. And the same edge, if I zoom in over here, is completely disappearing. You can see it here, because this is the Y direction, this direction, right? So if I see it here, that edge is gone completely, because that is actually running in the X direction. That is completely missed when I use the kernel, which is enhancing in this direction. Whereas if you see this part, this is enhanced like beautifully here. So you can see over here, right? I mean, compared to these two, right? You can see that. So this is a beauty. So you can control which direction you want to highlight. Okay. So that's an important aspect. And then you have the two diagonal directions also. We can see that in this case, this direction is actually beautifully enhanced, whereas this direction is missing. And for example, the other direction, maybe I don't know where to see. Yeah, probably this guy. This you see this guy. This is not enhanced here, but it is enhanced because it is enhancing in this direction. So that's the beauty about it. And now let's see the Sobel operator. The Sobel operator has some difference, right? You are actually weighting the middle part slightly higher, and in that way you can see there is an averaging also happening, and you can reflect that. So just see the size. Generally, the trend remains sort of same. Let me just bring that up. Okay, so only one diagonal component shown. But you can see actually the thickness of the border. Say, for example, X, this thickness is increased. Or they, you see this guy. Okay, so let me just Z this one. So here the edges are not very highlighted, but you're stressing that more because that two factor comes here and it's very clearly highlighted. Otherwise, Sx will not enhance anything in this vertical direction, whereas Sy will enhance that in vertical direction, but the horizontal direction components, for example here, compared to here, is completely gone, and the diagonal also. But in general, the thickness of the edge is increased. Okay, and now let me just show you the Laplacian also. Okay, so that's also important. So this is the Laplacian, which means sort of I took the isotropic kernel, and you can see that it's sort of same throughout. This is really not the absolute value. Okay, so this is actually the let me just check. I think it's absolute value. Yeah, it's absolute value. So correct. So you can see there is something which is very interesting trend. Okay, so if you see here, so there is a two local peaks are shown here, and there is a reason why that happens. So I have that in the upcoming slide, so I will not explain it now, but you just notice the difference between Laplacian and the other kernels, which are actually sort of directional, right? I mean, just keep that in mind, and now let's actually revisit. Okay, so let me just go back to the slides. So this part is very clear to you, just skip through. Okay, so this is what I wanted to highlight to you. Okay, so you have an image. Okay, so this is an image which has lot of edges, and if I draw a line like this, if I draw a line like this, okay, let me just draw it for you. So if I draw a line like this and plot, that's what you are actually seeing it over here. So you have sort of gradual change in intensity, that's what actually showing over here. And then you have a, in fact, actually this is exactly drawn here, okay? So along this line, because you see a bright spot here, and that bright spot is actually reflecting here, okay? So let me just remove all this, draw it fresh. So we are basically plotting a line along this bright spot, and that's what you're seeing over here. So a bright spot, then this edge is basically this guy over here, and then of course this sudden edge, which is actually shown here, okay? So basically this is this region. Okay, so this edge is basically this point over here. So this guy is over here, and then this transition is over here. Okay, so this edge. Okay, so that's it. So now if I apply Sobel, okay, Sobel filter, I get something like this. Don't worry about how I achieve the color. It is nothing but instead of grayscale, I can go and set a different color. Okay, you change the C map color map to jet, you will get something like this. Okay, so ignore that. So you can actually see the difference between this is Laplacian and this is actually Sobel filtering, and this is the intensity range you can see. So this guy, if I zoom in, let me just zoom in for you. So you can see over here, this is an extremely high value which is going to 400 in, and this sort of going to an extremely high value here also. So that is this edge basically, this guy. Okay, so that is the case. Now the point I want to convey, if you see again, plot the line plot along this and along this, that's shown over here and here. So important aspect that you're seeing over here, okay? So if you see over here, you can actually see that there is a dip. If you see the there is, whenever there is a start and end. So this guy, in both the cases, is a gradual change that is lost in both the cases. You can see it looks like a noise, right? In both the cases, you can see over here also. It looks like a some amount of noise, okay? And this peak is actually picked up, but if I zoom in, okay, if I zoom in, you can see that there are two peaks, okay, and the dip in the center, okay, and then here also same, okay, so this guy also, you can see there is a dip in the center, and here there is actually a sudden change, okay, a sudden change is actually having a gradual sort of thing in nature, okay, so that's interesting. And now coming back to Laplacian, you actually have a sign change. If you see here, okay, so this is actually not absolute value, the actual value, you see sign change, okay, so there is a sign change and also a peak. This peak is exactly coming at the peak of the signal, okay, so this particular bright spot that is pinpointed here, whereas that is missing here, okay. And then if you see here also, this change, this guy over here is actually having again a sign change and a peak is picked. So there are certain interesting aspects. So first one, which is quite noticeable for you, is first order derivatives, okay, both Sobel and Roberts generally produce thicker edges. You can play with it, actually. You can just go back and see for yourself whether this makes sense. So generally they make thicker edges, Okay. Second derivatives have stronger response. Okay. So you can actually see that it has a stronger response to fine details. That is thin lines, isolated points, and noise. It has stronger response, which is shown sort of here, right? But if the things are sharper, then of course both of them are similar. But the response is actually more sort of, when I say stronger response, is not really the amount of intensity alone. It's more about the sharpness also. Okay, the sharp intensity or the sharp rise is clearly shown in the Laplacian. Okay, so that's one important aspect. Second derivative has another important aspect. It produces double-edged response at the ramp and step transition. So here, for example, so this is actually a step. You can see over here, this is a step, right? So it actually shows, and in fact here also, it shows whenever there is a ramp or a slow increase, it always show, you can actually find out from here where is the start and where is the end of the transition, as well as the center of the transition. Okay, so that's the important aspect. The zero crossing here will show you the center of the transition, and the negative and the positive peaks will show you the start and end of the transition. Okay, so that's the important aspect. And the sign, okay, the sign of the second derivative. So this is negative. It can be used for the nature of the, it can be used to judge the nature of the transition. So you see a negative, right? A negative to zero means the intensity is going from low value to high value. If it is the ulta, maybe I don't know. Yeah, this portion is better. So the bright line to the dark line, you can see over here. Okay, so the transition is from the positive to negative. So that clearly, I mean, the sign of the second derivative or the Laplacian could be used to actually determine the nature of the transition. Okay, so certain interesting aspects about the difference between the first order and the second order differentiation. Beyond that, we studied actually in the previous lectures. So this is worth noticing. It's really, I mean, this is all observations. There's nothing really that you need to actually by heart here. It's all from observations and from experience. You will understand all these finer aspects. Now let's take some real life examples similar to the cameraman image. So all these you already, sort of observed in the cameraman image. So I just wanted to reiterate this again here. Okay, so this is a wire bound mesh image, sort of you can say the sort of magnified image of a wire bound in a PCB. Okay, so you can actually see that. So this is the original image. If I take Laplacian, this is the Laplacian. So you can see the labels here. So this is the Laplacian of the image, and the magnified image you can actually see over here, that transition I was talking about in the previous slide, right? So this guy, this over here, you can see that it is changing from dark to bright and bright to dark, and all the transitions along with the center is nicely picked up. So that is very, very evident actually in the case of a Laplacian. Okay, and then C and D are actually the absolute, this is the original negative included the original Laplacian image, and this is basically the absolute value. Okay, so if I take the absolute value of this guy, I get this, and if I take only positive values of this guy, I get this. Okay, so you can actually do a lot of stuff. This is just showing you the operations that you can do actually. So you can obviously see, if you are worried about all the edges, not worried about direction, you can actually use this. If you want to actually say I want only the certain transition, let's say positive or the low value to high value transition, then I can do something like this. Okay, so all these edges are actually the edges where there is a low transition to high transition. Okay, because only positive values are considered. If I consider only negative values, it shows all the places where there is a transition from a high value to a low value. So those are the different applications you can come up with by using Laplacian operation. Okay, yeah. And now if I use instead of Laplacian, if I use directional kernels, which are something like these examples you can see over here. So this one is actually, I am saying it is sort of horizontal. The reason is actually there is this direction, right? I mean, if you see over here, 2-1 is going actually. So this is mostly this direction, and this is mostly plus 45 degrees. We are considering sort of so minus 45, if you see over here, is okay. Let me just draw it for you. Okay, so they call basically the positive values are in this direction as minus 45, and the positive values in this direction as plus 45. Okay, and then of course you have the these two components also. So you can actually design your own kernels. I mean, you can even play with the earlier kernels that we had. So I just wanted to emphasize you, there are different possibilities. Okay, so this is actually a horizontal kernel, this is a vertical kernel. So these two are just 90 degrees to each other, and then you have plus 45 and minus 45 here. And if I apply these kernels on the filter, okay, you take, I mean, obviously I hope all of you understand that this is a 3x3. So all you have to do is you go 3x3 blocks, right, the convolution operation, and then you come up with the final result will look like all these. Okay, so let's see what are all these actually. So this is the original image. Okay, so this is result of processing with plus 45. Okay, so this guy is shown here, and you can actually see some of the diagonal elements only are highlighted. The horizontal vertical is completely disappeared from here, right? That's very clear. And this guy is zoomed view of this guy. Okay, so basically this part is zoomed and shown here, and this part is zoomed and shown here. Okay, so that's the case. And then what is this guy? Okay, so this is E, the image in B with all negative values set to 0. So this is this guy is this guy with all less than values great less than 0 is equal to 0 will give you this. And then this guy should be the opposite. So greater than some threshold, if it is less than that threshold, it is kept, and that's what you're seeing over here. Okay, so various things you can do. Again, these are all manipulations, don't worry about all these. So the ultimate takeaway for you is that you can design the kernel, you can choose the kernel so that some direction is enhanced or kept, some directions are gone. You can have an isotropic kernel like Laplacian, and then find out even there also you can actually do something, some thresholding to find out the high to low transition, for example, right? So all these interesting aspects you can actually do. Okay, so moving on, now let's go it a more official, let's read in a more mathematical way. Okay, so if you consider edges, now we need to think about what kind of edges are possible in all, if you combine all types of images that is common across images, we can broadly classify them into three classes. Okay, so one is actually the ideal edge or the step edge, which is very, very rare. Okay, so it means that there is a sudden transition, okay, sudden change in intensity. As you can see, this is the image, and this is one line plot. Okay, so this column is the image, and this row is the image, and this row is the one line plot along one of these rows, okay, in the image. So this is sudden transition, and here it's a ramp edge, which is very, very common. And then there is a roof edge, where actually you have increase maximum then decrease, so something like this, right? So that's what exactly possible. I think this is sort of the best you could do. If I want to classify edges into three classes, you can have sharp edges, which is sudden transition, you can have gradual edges, which is like ramp, and you can have roof edges. Okay, so let me take an example. Okay, so this is the CT image of skull. Okay, and you can actually take three different regions and show that it belongs to one of these class. So if I take somewhere here, it belongs to this class, right? And if I take this, this sort of belongs to this class, and if this belongs to this class. So this region, right, and then this region, and then this region. So three different regions in the same image has three different characteristics. So that actually shows that you can come up with bunch of lot of algorithms, right? I mean, I can have three separate algorithms running, one tuned for ideal edges, one tuned for ramp edges, one tuned for roof edges, right? And it's incredibly beautiful. I mean, if you know the physics of the image, if I know the image is something like this, and I observe that there are these kinds of edges possible, then same kernel throughout will not work, right? So that's where all the skill set of you as an image processing engineer, once you finish this course, that's where your role is, because there are a bunch of algorithms available, bunch of filters available, what to use when is actually fully in your hand. Okay, so I will stop with this slide. Okay, and probably I want to highlight something. So out of these three edges, the most common is this without any doubt. Actually, you can tell that that's a most common edge. And if I take that edge, okay, so this is one example. If I take one line along this, that will look like this. And if I take first derivative of this, obviously it looks like this. Okay, so if this is constant, if this guy is constant, first derivative will definitely look like this. And second derivative, again, one more derivative of this will look like this. And this was what I was telling you, it really shows, because this going from high to low, that's why a positive peak, and then there is a negative peak, because it goes from, at this stage, it goes from the other way, sorry, think the other way, right? So low to high, that's what it is picked up, and then high to low, that's what the negative peak is all about. So that all those aspects you can relate over here, and you can have zero crossing also, which exactly shows the center of this particular edge. Okay, and now from all our knowledge about first and second order derivatives on the edges, what we can actually generalize in certain way, which will be extremely useful. You can keep coming back to this slide whenever you work on edge enhancement problems. That magnitude of the first derivative will give you presence of edges, right? You can actually see that. So magnitude of the first, in fact, second derivative also, because if I take magnitude, this will look like this, right? So you can actually know the presence of edges, okay? Sign of the second derivative, we can actually see, right? Whether the edge is going from high to low or low to high, that part is very clear. Second derivative also produces two values for every edge, right? And zero crossing will give you the exact center point of the edge. That's very, very important, right? So these certain aspects, and of course, one missing point I would like to add over here, I will put a dot, and this should come from your previous knowledge, is like first order derivative, okay, even gx and gy could give you the direction of edges. We'll see that, okay, which is not highlighted here because we already saw that, right? So tan inverse of gy by gx will give you the direction of the edges, in which direction the edge is actually going, okay? So that's very important. We will revisit that in the next few slides, okay? So that's it. So we'll stop here, and then we will build on the edge detection algorithms, okay? One by one, we will go from very basic algorithms, and then we will go towards some advanced algorithms. Now I'll put for one aspect, maybe I'll show this image, a trivia, and then we'll stop sort of the discussion today, I mean this lecture, okay? So you see over here, you see over here, in the case of, there's a lot of disturbance here, right? So that means each and every small variation is actually enhanced or shown in this image, which we really don't want. So what shall we do to avoid all this? Just think about this, and we'll have that answer in the next lecture. I hope it's very easy for you to judge that. And that's all for this lecture. We'll see the remaining part of it in the next lecture. Okay, thank you.